Next by Dr. P. J. Mohanram.
So, good afternoon to all of you. I start with two advantages. One is, of course, a very strict 5-slide, 10-minute fatwa that was issued. And second is, out of my 5 slides, only this is new. All the rest have already been shared by the previous participants. So, at the end of the talk, if you say, so what's new, I will humbly confess there's nothing new. So, I'll just freewheel along for a little while. I tried to define what we really mean by inclusive manufacturing. And I thought that it can be done in two ways. One is manufacturing that brings products and technologies that are affordable to all sections of society and sustainable in the long run, which is what we have been talking about since morning. And second thing, which perhaps has not been touched upon, is that manufacturing that enables persons who face challenges to participate by creating suitable environments for them. We have a lot of people in manufacturing today who are either visually impaired or physically impaired. But still, society is finding a way to make it possible for them to operate a machine or do an assembly or do a quality control. So that's something that perhaps we need to address as well. So in any case, what driver can society use? I think this has not been put in the title slide, but I think the driving force should be to think local, make local, and market global, which is what I think the speakers also said yesterday morning when they said, why don't we go from centralized to distributed manufacturing. What are some examples? If you look at produce local and process local, we can look at farm produce in a big way. I believe around 40% of whatever fruits and vegetables we produce are lost in this country because they are not processed locally. They are transported and a lot of wastage. So if you have food processing, if you make your ketchups and juices locally and then produce and then transfer and then sell them globally, you will not only save a lot of produce, but you will get derive value for what is otherwise wasted. Now, best example is Amul brand. Previous speaker also said that. And I don't think there's anything which can illustrate this better than the Amul brand. Nirma is another example. It is a pure cottage industry driven by local skills. And Lijjat Papad. So we have examples with us. Now, these are in normal application technologies. But I would like also to say that in high technology, India has been a pioneer in inclusive technologies. We go from manufacturing to technologies. If you look at SIGHT, which is the Satellite Instruction Television Experiment, which was done in the 1970s, it was the first experiments of its kind in the world. When we took satellite technology to beam classroom material into villages. And we have INSAT, which of course penetrates every home in the country today. And BARC's technology transfer for irradiating potatoes and other farm produce, that again is inclusive technology which has grown from a high level to a very wide distribution. But what further can we do into today's technology-driven world? I think we have to use connectivity, which has been spoken about by previous speakers as well. Professor Tiwari said you have to use the cloud as an enabler to get technology across. And one of the things is that if you really want to convert centralized to distributed manufacturing, we must look at microfactories. And here, surprisingly, I must confess the term microfactory is not new. It was coined by my boss in the 80s. He said, why are you making all your parts in the HMT main factory? Why don't you just get this done in the villages? And I remember that he drove one of my colleagues mad, and he asked him to go to INSAT and find out how we can transfer drawings in those days. So maybe that was ahead of its time, but today it's entirely possible that you can get a crankshaft or a component made for the factories in a village in Andhra Pradesh or in Bihar or anywhere, and then make that your manufacturing base. All that you need is possibly the connectivity and a good power supply. Teleservices can flow from small towns and villages across the globe. This is already happening as a compulsion because of population pressure, infrastructure inadequacy. We are already having call centers which are moving to the smaller towns. And ethnic design studios and services, people talked about the local traditional trades. For instance, if you take manufacturers of object art, like Moradabad is in brass, Chennapatna in wooden toys, unfortunately, these people have lived with old designs. They may be ethnically correct and they may be ethnically good for the Indian audience. But since today we are trying to look global, what are the new designs that people want? So you need design houses. So, as Professor Tiwari said, you need to have a cloud which stores design. I can sit here and design for a US market or a Brazilian market, load it up, and Moradabad can produce it and export it directly. It's not necessary that every person should be trained as a designer. That service can come from outside. Recycling, refurbishing, and remanufacturing is a big opportunity. In India, actually, nothing is wasted. Our Rabdiwala collects everything from used paper to a torn piece of cloth. Nothing is ever wasted, but unfortunately, there is no technology applied. It's primitive, it has health hazards, and it eats away a lot of resources in inefficient transport and handling. So this is where I think technology must be applied. And remanufacturing is a very big this thing. If you take a washing machine, why do you throw it away after 10 years? In fact, Siemens have got a robotic way of dismantling an old washing machine and making it new. So now in our country, we can do that using the labor content in the smaller towns and rural areas. And yesterday, somebody presented about the 2G bioethanol technology. Now, if it's all that good, what is the country waiting for? I think we should have that technology which converts agri-waste into bioethanol in 24 hours. You should have a distributed system, maybe 5 centers in Bangalore, 10 centers in Bangalore, and everywhere. So this is the way we should look at spreading technology. And what can the approach be to spread inclusive manufacturing? We can identify local resources and talents, plenty of it available. Adopt natural advantage as they apply to such local areas, which is what Adam Smith said. You have to use the local advantage to leverage your knowledge and skills. But then you have to tune them to meet present market demand. You can't work with existing market demand. The world is moving very fast. Even Indians want new designs. So that has to be done. And then apply technology judiciously to bring up scale. I mean, we know that Tirupati Laddu is now automated. It's no longer made by hand, this thing. Now, if Madhur Vada is given a geographical indication tag and gets an IP, then technology can step in to make it go global. You can buy Madhur Vada and order it online, maybe from New York, and it can be delivered to you. So that's a kind of enablers that you have to look at. And what is manufactured by machine locally should be a global product. So you should be able to book it online, whether it's a food item or this thing. And inclusive manufacturing, I did some Google search and I found that, if I were younger, I would have possibly called up Cortina or Siri, but I, being older, I stuck to Google. And I simply Googled inclusive manufacturing. Actually, only one serious this thing came up, that was the University of Pittsburgh. They seem to have a formal program in inclusive manufacturing, but that's the other type. That is to get people who are not physically endowed to participate in the manufacturing process. They have got programs and development projects for the seriously talented. And we could now look at how we control machines by touch, by voice, by tactile feedback, and also ergonomically engineer products so that a challenged person can sit and operate a machine comfortably. And the man-machine robot cooperation. Today, it's no longer necessary that, in fact, people are not doing full automation. They are using cobots, where robots work alongside man to take out the drudgery or the heavy weight lifting, but leave the sensitive portion for operation by man. So these are some of the things that we should also look at the other side, that is inclusive manufacturing for the less abled people. So that's what I wanted to convey. And I don't know whether I've met, I think I have met 10 minutes deadline.
Thank you very much for the opportunity.